Joining me once again is Rose Fres Fausto. She's a behavioral economist. She is known as the FQ Mom. And of course, she's also a writer and speaker on money and family. So today we are going to talk about how to keep the kids productive and sane during this EQ period. Rose, thanks so much for joining me once again. This time we're talking about the children because obviously it's the summer months. So usually they're out with their friends or, you know, they have all of these summer classes or even on holidays, you know, like taking trips to our islands or to different countries. So how do we keep these kids productive? And do they have to be?
Okay.
Do they have to be during this period?
Yeah, so hi to all the parents and children out there. You've been together for over a month, 24/7. And probably this is unprecedented. I'm saying that this is probably the longest time that we've been together forever and never to part, so to speak. Yeah, so it's a challenge for us family members, no matter how much we love each other, to be always together 24/7. So for kids out there, it really depends. Are they very young kids, school age kids, or are they just like my kids who are already all working boys? No, there are now a lot of accidental school. I mean, what do you call that? Homeschool parents right now.
Even though they're on summer break.
Yes.
Speaking specifically of kids who are already done with school, because the Philippine school system, it ended already sometime in March.
Yes, for at least for the grade school, high school, The college not yet done.
Correct.
So really, if it's summertime, it has to be more of a relaxed kind of activities. I do remember when my sons were young, when I would pick a summer activity for them, I'd try to avoid the cerebral kind. I would go for the athletic, sports, artistic, and they would be the ones choosing. But I also didn't over-schedule them because I wanted them to have what we call the time para tumanga. Time for you to be creative on your own, to think of the things that you'd like to do. So I guess that could also be applied. And there are a lot of resources online right now. Like there's starter moms, DIY activities with your toddlers. And then there are also a lot of classes that they can attend right now. Again, as I said, unless your kids are like the math wizards who really love to learn some more. So if that's the case, go ahead, no? So I also did a bit of a survey among my friends, especially those with still school-age children. And this is what they've been doing. Well, number one is to teach them household chores.
Very important. It's a life skill.
It is a life skill.
And now, so, as parents, you have time to do that.
Yeah, that's right. So most of them, and this is actually a family tradition. I started when the boys were still young. Every Holy Week, we wouldn't really go out for out-of-town vacation. We would really cull our closets. This is the time to also go through their closets and now segregate what are the things that they still use, keep, and then what do they want to donate, what do they want, what can they sell. Maybe some of them have not been even used, no? So that's one. And then they have to help also in the cooking, washing dishes, etc., especially for those who sent their household helpers home for the lockdown.
Rose, a lot of parents, I guess with the fast-paced times and all of this, when the kids get to do chores, sometimes they use it as the reason to give them like an allowance.
Okay.
Sort of, you know, in terms of helping them also learn to deal with money and how when you work, you know, you get money and what to do with it. Do you think that this is a good time, or should chores be, because it's so unprecedented, should chores be a necessity because we're all just pulling our own weight in the household?
You know, when I was growing our sons, when we were parenting them and they were at their young age, I had that ambivalence about paying for housework. So at first I did try to specify some chores like watering the plants, etc., and it had a fee. But then I became uncomfortable about it. So there are two schools of thought here. One is just giving allowance and the other one is you make your children earn. So If you believe that it is right to make your children earn by doing household chores, you just have to be very careful about what chores should not be paid. You should not pay them to do personal hygiene. Excuse me, nobody should should get paid for brushing his teeth, right? Or cleaning up their room.
Now let's shift over to gadgets. I mean, unfortunately, we are living in an online world because of, you know, the enhanced community quarantine. So are all of the screen time rules out the window? How do people traverse this particular issue?
Okay, for parents, first siguro is to really look at your own screen time. I am sometimes guilty about that. And you know what I've done already? Because work and leisure are both done on screen. So you can always make that palusot, oh, no, but I'm answering an email, etc. So what I've done is to really put a cap on. I tried to do a cap on the screen time. But you know what became more effective for me is to really shut it off at a certain hour. For me, it's 11 o'clock. Nothing can be accessed anymore by 11 p.m. So I should be sleeping at the time. Because there are times when I would think of something and I'd like to just write down a note, but then I end up opening my email, my Facebook, etc., etc. So when it comes to trying to discipline your kids, look at your own discipline first.
Correct.
And then pass it on to your children. So for me, mealtime, we have to get rid of gadgets during mealtimes. And for, especially for young kids, there really has to be a limit. It's going to affect their brain development.
So that's a good thing though, because unfortunately all of the activities that are offered for the summer for now, because we're all in our homes, is online. Mm-hmm. So how do you sort of strike that balance? Unfortunately, these are the times we're living in for now.
Yeah, so for really young kids, the parents should really set the rules and really follow through. There is a certain number of hours that a child, and in fact, somebody below 2 years old should not be given screen time. And then for those who are two and above, siguro up to grade school, there has to be a limit. Talk about it, and it has to be a rule that you both agree to, not necessarily keep putting the same weight on the parents and the child, but it has to be agreed on so that it is easier to implement. And we know what happened during the younger years of the boys. When I was away, they would implement the rules on each other. So you also need that. You also need that support.
Well, that was a power play, I think.
Yeah. And don't forget that you can still do a lot of physical activities.
Well, that was my next point, because exercise at this point, like let's say you don't have a garden, or because now a lot of villages don't even allow you to step out of your house into the streets. Because I suppose at this point with COVID-19, we're not exactly sure how contagious it is. The airborne debacle or debate, you know, we don't know. So it's still safest to stay home. So in a really small space, how do you get them to exercise? Because I think exercise is necessary on a daily basis. Is this the case?
So maybe for those who are also fond of dancing, like our family is, we have a workout Wednesday that is led by my son. And we really do sweat a lot, no? So for those who are alone, living alone, you can even do that. Just go to your playlist, your favorite Spotify playlist, and do some dance exercise. And also when it comes to weights, you know, just a couple of liter of bottles of water. You can use those as weights if you don't have a gym at home.
I can imagine these little kids doing that. Because, I mean, for the parents, though, how do they get these young kids to exercise? Because with the older ones, you know, their online ballet classes, if they're still in ballet, or even soccer has a lot of it. But what about the younger ones who are naturally, you know, antsy and just need to expel all of this energy?
Yeah, I think the secret there is to take out the gadget, because a two-year-old, a toddler, even probably up to the age of 8, is naturally an active person.
Right.
So there was this experiment before where an athlete just followed a two-year-old toddler doing all the things that he was doing, and the athlete got tired. So we are just now substituting that activity with the screen time. So take out the screen, and for sure, your young kid would be doing all these activities again, the physical activities. So it's really a matter of design. That's what we do. That's what we believe in behavioral economics, that really the willpower cannot be counted on all the time. You have to make it easy for you to do the right thing. The default design of your homes should such that it is easier to eat the right kind of food. It is easier to do some exercises. So really it's a challenge. But now that we have a lot of time at home and really go through our things, it is opportune to really make use of what we have at home, no matter how big or small your space could be. I think a little bit of exercise can be put in there. And you know, there's one more activity that I noticed and happening not just in our family, but other families. No? Because of the online mass, mm-hmm. So it's now easier to do it together.
Right.
So maybe that, and some of the people I interviewed, they've been able to do, the Catholics at least, their daily rosary.
Oh, right. I mean, we're talking about family togetherness. So this is the next,
right.
This is the next topic, you know, of personal space, because, you know, maybe some people have bigger houses, but others don't necessarily have big houses, and you're confined to a space with now 4, 5, 6 people. And maybe some of them are teenagers that sort of need their space. So how do you, is too much family too much? Because we're together all the time, every day, all of our, every single activity is pretty much together, except for those obviously who work from home and yeah. have their personal offices set up. But what about for everybody else?
So it's now important to put some structure into it. So decide on what spaces, what which family member would be occupying at a certain time. So if one member gets the dining table, the other one gets the kitchen counter or the bedroom, wherever the internet, the Wi-Fi is strongest for somebody who's going to have an online meeting, there has to be a structure. If you are challenged by a small space, I think it's a matter of, you come up with a timetable there. You sign up, what time will you be using this for? And then just designate a time, and that could probably be just the meal times where you would be together, so that the conversation would still be healthy and fun and not really nakakasawa because we're always together 24/7.
In terms of addressing fears and even questions about COVID-19 and the pandemic and the community quarantine and why it's happening, how do you answer these questions or soothe their worries? Because a lot of times the parents themselves show worry because yeah. it's such a different time.
It has to be an age-appropriate basis. So if a child asks, Mom, are you going to die? You just have to try to explain in the words that he or she could understand. And you also have to put a limit, because there was a time, especially at the start, when everything that we were talking about was about COVID, mm-hmm. whether it was upon waking up, during meals, upon sleeping. So you have to put a limit to that. It was my youngest son who requested. He asked that, can we just limit the COVID conversation to this and that time? And so when he pointed that out, we started just talking about something else during meals.
You know, I like that you said that it was age appropriate, because obviously your kids are a little older and they're adults already, so they're understanding the situation. But for, let's say, a 2-year-old who maybe has caught a glimpse on TV of, you know, people in their hospital beds, yes. and just I guess fear in general, like, why can't I see my grandparents? Why, yeah. you know, why all of a sudden things are so different from what I know, and kids are so used to structure and schedules, right?
Yeah. And then what you can also do is to try to do something to help. A lot of families are allotting some time helping with the different fundraising activities and even making face masks or even snacks that they could send out to the frontliners. So when there is an activity, you are not frozen in fear. So maybe that could help.
Okay, so maybe final tips on parents who are either already ready to give the kids back to the community, because for this long, I mean, from 24/7, or to even parents who are loving this so much and yet not understanding that maybe their kids are not loving it so much, you know, because there are two types of scenarios as well. I mean, lucky for the middle ground ones who are just happy all around, but I'm sure this pandemic has also caused some concerns, fears, irrational behaviors, you know, yeah. in members of the family.
Yeah, so for families out there, we have to acknowledge that we have never seen anything like this before, and it's all right to be afraid, to be fearful, to be stressed, but we have to put a limit to that, because when we keep that, it's over a month already, we now have to put down those chemical reactions that's happening, and we now have to try to find a new normal for all of us. For children, try to find some productive activities for them. We are now done with the part when you don't really have to be productive. We now have to brace ourselves for what's going to happen after the lockdown. How will the new normal be for each one of us? And then for those with older children, and I am guilty of that, even if we are so loving that we are with our big boys 24/7, you also have to give them space. Talk about it. And then you try to just make the most of this this pandemic. You know, this is an opportunity to really connect with each other, to really understand each other, and go back to basics.